Alleluia.
Christ is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Pray. Almighty and everlasting God, who in the Paschal mystery established the new covenant of reconciliation, grant that all who have been reborn into the fellowship of Christ's body may show forth in their lives what they profess by their faith. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need. The word of the Lord.
A reading from the first letter of John. We declare to you what was from the beginning, what we have heard, what we have seen with our eyes, what we have looked at and touched with our hands concerning the word of life. This life was revealed, and we have seen it and testify to it, and declare to you the eternal life that was with the Father and was revealed to us. We declare to you what we have seen and heard, so that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly, our fellowship is with the Father and with His Son, Jesus Christ. We are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. This is the message we have heard from Him and proclaimed to you, that God is light, and in Him there is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with Him while we are walking in darkness, we lie and do not do what is true. But if we walk in the light as He Himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, His Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, He who is faithful and just will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make Him a liar, and His word is not in us. My little children, I am writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. The word of the Lord.
Jesus lives, I tell you. though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Jesus has died, has descended to the dead for a couple days. We don't know, we don't get a lot of information about his whereabouts during that time. But now, on the testimony of the women at the grave and even Simon Peter and the disciple Jesus loved, who tradition tells us is John, the grave is now empty, and some have seen and believe that Jesus is not there. They don't know where he is, but he is not there. As the disciples return to their homes, it is Mary who stays at the gravesite and sees the Lord. For the others, they are back processing these events. When our reading occurs, it's later that same day, and the disciples are behind locked doors. When Jesus suddenly appears, although he could have reprimanded them for their unbelief or for running away from his actual death when he could have used some companionship, or even now for being locked down because of fear, Jesus simply greets them with peace. Peace, not fear, peace, not anxiety, peace, not guilt. As he breathes this peace on the disciples, he sends them to spread the news, which includes peace and forgiveness. He says, "As the Father has sent me, so I send you." But where is Thomas? And what is he doing as the disciples gather and are hunkered down together in fear? We hear in all of our lessons today, the believers unite in some way. In Acts, the whole group who believe were of one heart and one soul. In the short verses we heard from Psalm 33 that we sung together, it speaks of how good and pleasant it is when kindred live together in unity. 1 John speaks of that fellowship with the Father, the Son, and with one another. But when we get to the gospel lesson, the disciples, yes, are together. They're behind locked doors, but Thomas is missing. Was Thomas no longer afraid of those who had killed Jesus? Was he busy trying to get on with his life? I have to wonder if he was grieving disappointment, grieving for trusting that Jesus was the one, feeling like a fool. We aren't told. What we are told earlier in John is when Jesus had wanted to go to Bethany to raise Lazarus from the dead, the disciples had warned the people, had warned that the people were looking to stone him. But it's Thomas who's wanting to keep the group together. It's Thomas who said, "Let us go that we may die with him." But not today. Thomas is nowhere to be found. So the first person the disciples have to go tell is Thomas. "We have seen the Lord, Thomas. Jesus is alive. We weren't wrong." We have to get the band back together. There's work to be done, and people need to know this. Now, we know the story of Thomas, or at least we think we do. He gets a bad rap for his doubting and his needing proof. Yet, in actuality, when Thomas does see Jesus, he's the first to say to Jesus, "My Lord and my God." Not bad for a doubter. So with Thomas back on board, the work begins, and there won't be time to sort out all the creeds right now. That's going to take another 300 years or so, when they actually are in a time of peace. But for now, the disciples are in this together, and they're sent out by Jesus to spread this news. He is alive, and his message is one of peace, and it is about forgiveness. David Winter, and I have told this story before, and I'm going to tell it again because it's one of my favorites. But David Winter, a priest in the Diocese of Oxford, wrote a commentary on Handel's Messiah. And in it, he tells of speaking to a church regarding the need for Christians to go public with their faith, to proclaim it from the rooftops, using the words from Handel's oratorio. He says, "Perhaps I was a bit too enthusiastic, because a smartly dressed man sitting in the back remarked that he had always believed his faith was a private matter between him and God." Winter agreed that, of course, our faith is private and personal commitment is known only to God. But he continued by saying, "It's just as well the apostles hadn't taken the same view. Because if they had, the Christian faith may have just died out about AD 80 when the last of them toppled off their chair in the upper room, wondering if perhaps they should have told somebody that Jesus had risen from the dead." By the time of the stories in Acts and 1 John, the faith of the disciples has gone public, and we hear how they're taking their turn to tell the story to the next generation. But according to John, that is not how the message got started. It got started with questions, with doubts, and with fear. And there's no reason for us to believe that we won't encounter folks who have the same doubts, the same questions, and the same fears when we try to tell them about our faith, and especially about our resurrected Jesus. And this is where we pause. It isn't about us. The doors of people's hearts are sometimes locked, and only Jesus can walk through them. If we're honest, we waffle in our own faith and our beliefs and the details of the story. And when we don't know what to say, as Philip, the rector, reminded us last week, the only six words we really need are, "The Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah." And yet, because we live in that broken world, a world that doesn't understand our Christian lingo, and a world that we are wise not to forget how much God loves, it helps when we share Jesus' message of peace and when we are the leaders ourselves of forgiveness. He sent Jesus into the world so that you and I and even the thems out there can live. The Creator himself came to heal and restore his world. And the crazy part of it all is that God has chosen us to be the ones to tell it in all of our anxiety and all our fears and all our doubts, to go tell someone that Jesus has risen and that and his message goes in peace and forgiveness. Jesus is alive. Go in peace, my friends, and forgive as you have been forgiven. Amen.
Thank you. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Let us pray for the whole state of Christ's church and the world. Almighty and ever-living God, who in thy holy word has taught us to make prayers and supplications and to give thanks for all men, receive these our prayers, which offer unto the divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord, and grant that all those who do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word and live in unity and godly love. Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops and other ministers, especially for Michael, the presiding bishop, Rob, our bishop, for Philip, Cheryl, and Gray, our parish priest, and Steve, our seminarian, that they may, both by their life and doctrine, set forth thy true and lively word, and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. And to all people, give thy heavenly grace, and especially to this congregation here present, that with meek heart and due reverence, they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. We beseech thee also to rule the hearts of those who bear the authority of government in this and every land, especially for the president, the Congress, the courts, governors, mayors, and all those in positions of leadership, that they may be led to wise decisions and right actions for the welfare and peace of the world. Open, O Lord, the eyes of all people to behold thy gracious hand in all thy works, that rejoicing in the whole creation, they may honor thee with their substance and be faithful stewards of thy bounty. And we most humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and suffer and succor Martha, Grayson, and all those in this transitory life who are in sorrow, trouble, need, sickness, or any other adversity. And we also bless thy holy name for all thy servants departed in this life, thy faith and fear, especially Emily Sloan. Beseeching thee to grant them continual growth in thy love and service, and to grant us grace so to follow the good examples of all thy saints, that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant these our prayers, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate. Amen.
peace of the Lord be always with you. As our children are returning from Children's Chapel, please be seated. A warm good morning and welcome to all of you on this second Sunday in our season of Easter. Thank you for your time and your presence here on this beautiful Sunday morning. It's always a joy to look out and see all of you gathered here. If you are a newcomer in our midst, we are especially delighted to have you today. Thank you for joining us. Please make yourself known to us by filling out a newcomer card or saying hello to one of our greeters at the door. And just know again, we are very glad that you are here with us today. Speaking of a glad presence, I want to honor and give thanks for the presence of Dr. Nancy Josie, who is, good morning, Nancy, a friend and colleague. Nancy is a retired Episcopal priest here in the Wilmington area. Many of you know her already. She is a regular kind of helping us here and also up at St. Mary's in Burgaw. We're delighted to have her here this morning in our midst. Gray and Katie are at a wedding down in Florida right now, so Godspeed to them and their travels back up here today. Just a reminder, as we started last month, we've returned to the tradition of a healing chapel on the first Sunday of every month. So Nancy and Cheryl both will be in our chapel this morning during the distribution of the Eucharist. If you'd like to come after Eucharist and have a healing blessing for yourself or someone you love and know, please know that all are warmly invited to come over to the healing chapel for this, the first Sunday in the month of April. I do want to point out that we have some wonderful things coming up in April and in May, so do pay attention to the Grapevine, which has just been published, and also the announcements on the back of our program today, with a special emphasis on a special offering from the St. James Speaker Series. That will be the Bonhoeffer in a Time of Responsibility. It's a four-part series that's being offered beginning April 16th, led by Dr. Wayne Floyd, who is a renowned expert on Dietrich Bonhoeffer. There is more information on the back. There will be a dinner offered and then the presentation in our Great Hall on Tuesday evenings, beginning the 16th of April. So do pay a little more attention to signing up for that if you wish to come. And a special fact is that Dr. Wayne Floyd is the husband of Dr. Nancy Josie, who is here with us today. So he comes highly recommended. Yes, Nancy? Yes, two thumbs up. So I hope all of you can attend that important presentation as well. Youth Sunday is right around the corner. That's the Sunday we pause to give thanks for and celebrate our graduating seniors and our youth in general. So that will be Sunday morning, the 21st of April. Lots of wonderful things happening right here and right now. Finally, I have a big note. Take lilies home today, please. So after our service, if you would like to take one of our Easter lilies with you, all are warmly welcomed, I dare say encouraged, to take a lily or two with you on your way home today. So please enjoy those and have them. Okay, lots to be grateful for this day. Now let us walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us with an offering and a sacrifice to God.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right
and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death he has destroyed death, and by his rising to life again he has won for us everlasting life. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia. Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast.
Alleluia.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts and by faith and with thanksgiving. All are welcome. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Amen. The God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
To love and serve the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia. Alleluia.